So, how many overall comparisons was that? Well, let's try to find a pattern here. It looks like at each step, we did one less comparison than the array we were building. So, when we were building an array of 7, we only did 6 comparisons. When we were building an array of 3, we did 2 comparisons. An array of 2, 1 comparison. And an array of 4, we did 3 comparisons. I'm going to go ahead and call the length of each array m just to make it a little easier for me. So if m is the size of the array that we're building, the number of comparisons is always going to be one less than that. It's going to be hard to get an exact number of comparisons here. However, we have a good friend that we can count on, approximation. Since we know that every iteration just cycles through the same 7 elements again and again, we know that the size of our arrays, or m, are always going to add up to 7 at the end. So again, here we have an array of 7, here we have an array of 4 and an array of 3, which adds up to 7, and here 1, 2, 2, and 2 adds up to 7. Since we're just doing divide and conquer, splitting up the array at each step, we can say that approximately we're going to do 7 comparisons at each step. Again, 7 is an upper bound. We're never going to do more than 7 comparisons, but at many steps we get close to 7. So to get the runtime of a sorting algorithm, you can normally multiply the number of overall iterations by the number of comparisons at each iteration. In bubble sort, we were doing n comparisons and n steps. We just proved that we're doing at most n comparisons at every step. But how many steps overall are we doing? Okay, so to sort an array of 7, we had to do 3 steps: 1, 2, and 3. Also, I should note some of the sub-processes that happened here. In order to sort this array of 2, we only had to do 1 step. When we were sorting an array of 3 or an array of 4, we needed to do 2 steps. We can use a nice table to keep track of all of that. Again, so when our array size was 7, we had to do 3 different steps. When our array was 3 or 4 numbers large, we had to do 2 steps. When our array was 2 large, we had to do 1 step. And if we just had 1 element, we don't need to do any comparisons, so no steps. I'm going to go ahead and fill in a few numbers here just for the sake of time. You can assume that I did these calculations on my own, and I encourage you to do them as well. Okay, so this might look a little bit familiar to you. Remember in binary search when we had a similar table, and the number of iterations incremented at every power of 2? Well, we actually have something pretty similar here. Instead of incrementing at the powers of 2, this time we're incrementing one after every power of 2. So in the binary search video, I proved why the number of iterations would be equal to log n. So if you need a refresher, you can go back there. Again, this time is a little different because it increments after the power of 2 instead of at the power of 2. Yet again, we're kind of relying on approximation here. We don't exactly care where the change happens as long as we capture the interval at which the change is happening. So in summary, we're doing roughly n comparisons for log n steps. That makes an overall complexity of n log n. This is definitely better than the n squared we got in bubble sort. In bubble sort, we had n times n, or n squared, as our efficiency. Log n is generally going to be less than n, but it's definitely never going to be greater than n. So we can say that the efficiency of merge sort is better than the efficiency of bubble sort. However, the space efficiency of merge sort is actually worse than bubble sort. In bubble sort, we were sorting in place, so we didn't need to use any extra arrays. Here, we frequently copied our values into new arrays. You can say that the auxiliary space, or the extra space we used, was linear. This complexity assumes that we got rid of arrays after we were done using them. At each step, we were copying values into new arrays, so we needed new arrays at some point. However, we could say that we were getting rid of the old ones whenever we were done, so we're not using a ton of new arrays every time. We really only need two different arrays at every step: the array that our numbers were in and the new array that we're copying the values into.